My people hear my teaching. Listen to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth with a parable. I will utter hidden things, things of the old, things we have heard and known, things our ancestors have told us. We will not hide them from their descendants. We will tell the next generation the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord, his power and the wonders he has done. Psalm 78 is a psalm that is a maskil. As you all know, the various psalms were written for various purposes. A maskil is a teaching song. This was written by Asaph. Asaph wrote this psalm as an educational song.
Yes.
One of the things about the Jewish race, I should say, the Jewish people, is that they kept very accurate track of history. The first five books of the Bible, known as the Pentateuch, were written by Moses. Ever since, the Jewish people kept very accurate track of their history. The purpose was to teach the future generation the teachings of God, the commandments of God, and his great works among them. So teaching was a very, very important process for the Jewish people. This psalm was written in the time of David and Solomon, and Asaph and his group of choir members sang this song to educate the people of Israel about the wonderful ways the Lord has carried them through adversities through the centuries. If you have time, read on the rest of the psalm, and that will give you a good synopsis of the story, the sufferings, the rebellions of Israel. The reason I chose this passage was not to extensively deal with it, but to simply say or point out that how important education is. What is education? Well, it is through education that we attain freedom, freedom from ignorance, and in many cases, freedom from poverty. What is freedom? It is defined as a condition of being free from restriction or control, or the right to act, believe, or express oneself in a manner of one's own choosing. As soon as we talk about freedom, the antonym comes to mind, which is slavery. What is slavery? Slavery is the state of being the legal property of another, where one is forced to obey the master or another person. So how can we attain freedom? Through education. And what's education? Education is the process of receiving or giving systematic instruction, especially at a school or university. Schools and universities are what come to our mind when we talk about education. One thing very special about education is the fact that this is one gift that keeps on increasing as we give it. In Malayalam, we say, "Kodukkum thorum eridum vidyadhanam sarvadhanal pradhanam." It's one item that will keep increasing as we keep giving. Will Durant said one time that education is the progressive discovery of our own ignorance. For some people, ignorance is bliss. However, through education is the most powerful weapon which you can use to change the world. And that was said by Nelson Mandela. Where does education come from? Education comes from all sources. Naturally, we think of schools and universities when we talk about education. But education is a lifelong process. The sages of India knew about it long before many books were written. And they said, Acharya Padamadatte Padam Shishya Sumethaya Padam Sabrahmacharibhya Padam Kalakramenadu. One fourth of our learning comes from teachers, universities, colleges. But about a fourth of the knowledge comes from our own efforts. The other fourth comes from our colleagues. And the last, only by time. That's why we always respect, traditionally, we Indians respect our older folks. We respect them, we obey them. We stand up when they walk into the room. Why? Because their experience is invaluable in educating us. So how can we receive freedom by education? Freedom was present when the world was created. Genesis verse 2 talks about freedom in a very hidden way. Apostle Paul opens that mystery to us later on in the New Testament. We'll come back to that in course of time. Genesis chapter 2 verse 16 says, And the Lord God commanded the man, Adam, saying, Of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat. That was freedom. Adam has the freedom to do anything he wanted. And as we read on in verse 19, we read, And out of the ground the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air and brought them unto Adam to see what he would call them. And whatsoever Adam called every living creature, that was the name thereof. So Adam had the freedom to name every animal and plant on the surface of the earth. That was freedom. The writer of Proverbs, the wisest man to ever live, considers education as very important. As a preamble to Proverbs, before he addresses his son, in a few sentences, he describes education. And later on tells his son, Magane enda vakkavelkuva, enda instruction chevidariya. So let us learn a little bit from the Bible about freedom, where it comes from, and how can we achieve true freedom. And before that, let's go on to how Adam lost his freedom. Thomas Jefferson, one of the founding fathers of this country, once said, Eternal vigilance is the price of freedom. When we get freedoms, we have to be vigilant because temptations are all around us. And that's how Adam lost his freedom. He was not vigilant. The Lord God commanded him, You're a free man. You can do anything you want. You can eat the fruit of any tree except one. And Adam was not vigilant. Eve was not vigilant. When Eve was told by the snake that, Oh, this is a beautiful tree. We eat and your eyes shall open. And she saw that the fruit was beautiful and probably very healthy to eat. So she took the fruit and ate it and gave it to Adam and he ate it. Both of them lost their vigilance for a moment. And what happened? That was disobedience. And what happened once they disobeyed? Genesis chapter 3. Verse 10. when the Lord came for his stroll in the garden in the evening, Adam and Eve went and hid. Why? Because they knew they had committed a sin. They disobeyed God. God called out for Adam, and Adam said, I hid you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid. So their sin was naked in front of God. So what did he do? Cover himself and hide. So that tells us one thing, the result of sin, the result of disobedience, the loss of the freedom. The freedom to freely move in that beautiful garden and enjoy its produce without labor. He lost it. God commanded both of them to leave the garden. So that's the price of sin. And that's the price of the lack of vigilance, or the vigilance they did not exercise. And what happened? With that came fear. The Bible says, I was afraid. So fear is the result of sin. The fear is the result of sin. So Adam's sin made him afraid. And what happened? With fear came anxiety. Anxiety is the inner feeling that all of us feel from time to time. It's the fear of the impending disaster, the impending doom. It entered the world because of one man's sin, Adam's sin. And it got perpetuated throughout history. Let me give you an example from the Bible. In Exodus chapter 1, verses 8 through 10, we read, Now there arose up a new king over Egypt, which knew not Joseph. And he said unto his people, Behold, the people of the children of Israel are more and mightier than we. Come on, let us deal with them wisely, lest they multiply and become strong. And when an enemy comes to us, they fall with them in war and fight against us. That's an example of fear. There was no reason for the Pharaoh to fear the people of Israel. They were living peacefully among the Egyptians. But the fear that invaded human hearts because of the original sin, took over. And he looked forward. He feared the power, the might of the Israeli people. And he was afraid. So what did he do? He decided to deal with them wisely. And we all know how it was done, so I'm not going to elaborate on that. So how can we get rid of this fear? One man's sin brought fear into our hearts. With fear came anxiety. And with anxiety and fear, they hid. That's what they did. But what do we do? Galatians chapter 5, verses 19 through 21. We deal in human solutions. Some turn to alcohol. Some turn to drugs. Some turn to other evils, which are listed in this paragraph, in these verses. The acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity and debauchery, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions and envy, drunkenness, orgies and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. These are the human solutions. These are the solutions of flesh, as the apostle details it there. So with sin came fear. With fear came anxiety. With anxiety came the solution to the flesh. And the apostle is warning us here that those who engage this in fleshly solutions shall never enter the kingdom of God. So instead of elaborating and spending a lot of time on what we all know, let's look at history. History is rampant with examples of people acting out of fear, acting or chasing freedom with their own solutions. Let's look at the Bible and the people of Israel. There arose a man by name Moses to deliver the people of Israel from that slavery. Pharaoh's design was slavery, to oppress them, to subjugate them, to make them labor and to enjoy the fruits of their labor. And God sent a man by name Moses. Moses went to Pharaoh. The story is familiar to all of us. And Moses' word, "Let my people go," echoed 10 times in the chambers of Pharaoh, raising chills through his administration. Eventually, after all the miracles, Pharaoh had to let them go. Israel was set free. But were they truly free? Israel went through the desert and eventually reached the promised land. If they were truly free, there was no need for Leviticus chapter 25, verse 10, which says, "The Lord commanded Moses on Mount Sinai to tell Israel to make the 50th year of their calendar year of Jubilee and to sound the trumpet of your will in that year." There was no need for it if they were truly free. "Proclaim liberty unto all the land." That's what the Lord told Moses. If they were free, why do you have to proclaim liberty? Yes, Moses was a man sent by God. But Moses could not make them free either. During the Reformation, against the religious oppression of the Roman Catholic Church, we see people rising up. We saw Martin Luther, the presentation of the Augsburg Confession. Zwingli, working in Switzerland, John Calvin in France, and Henry VIII in England. They all rose against the religious oppression of the Roman Catholic Church, and I will not go into details. You know the story of Pilgrim Fathers. They fled the oppression of the King of England. They set sail on Mayflower and Speedwell. Speedwell did not make it, but after a 66-day journey, Mayflower landed in Plymouth, on the eastern coast of the United States, and they established a nation, which we live in now. Forces of atheism, forces of destruction, forces of damnation, are trying to erase that history and rewrite the history of the United States. And we are going through that oppression. What's our deliverance? The United States itself went through slavery. And we know the story of Martin Luther King. And he spoke 100 years after the Declaration, after the Emancipation Declaration. He made the "I Have a Dream" speech. Was there a need for it if the slaves were truly freed in the United States? It did not happen. So where does true freedom come from? Let's look at the Bible again. The word liberty, which stands for freedom, occurs 8 times in the Old Testament and 18 times in the New Testament. And as I mentioned before, freedom was there at the time of the foundations of the earth. Genesis chapter 1, after Moses writes about the Lord created the heaven and earth, the next verse, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. So what does the Spirit of God have to do with freedom? Well, the key to that mystery is unlocked in Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17. Read there. Now, the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord, there is liberty or freedom. So Genesis verse 2 is actually telling us about freedom. Which is the freedom that Adam enjoyed? We studied, or we learned about the cause of Adam's bondage. We learned about how he sinned. We learned about how one man's disobedience resulted in all of us being sinners. In John chapter 8, verse 36, it tells us how we can be truly free. It tells us, if the Son therefore shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. So true freedom comes from the Son of God, Jesus Christ. As for one man's disobedience, many were made sinners. Romans chapter 5, verse 19. For as one man's disobedience, many were made sinners, so the obedience of one shall many be made righteous. So true freedom comes from the sacrifice of Jesus Christ upon the cross. John tells us, if the Son therefore shall make you free, we shall be free indeed. Today, that freedom is free to us. Someone said freedom is not free. Here is one freedom that is free. All we have to do is accept the Lord as our Savior. And once we accept that Son who gives us true freedom, the Bible tells us we are a new creature. The Spirit of God will dwell in us, and we shall produce the fruits of the Spirit, which we can see in Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23. But the fruits of the Spirit, we learned about the fruits of the flesh. Here are the fruits of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and temperance. My listeners, today I pray that freedom shall ring true in our hearts. As we live today, I pray that let that freedom be in our hearts. So we can say, free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, you're free at last. Thank you for listening. God bless you.